Hello, everybody, and welcome back to the third episode of the Is It Fun podcast. We actually made it to three. I'm here with my good friend Tripp again. Say hello, Tripp.
Hello, Greg.
How was your week, buddy?
It has been pretty rough so far, but yeah, I'm going to make it. I'm going to persevere.
Okay, I think I'm going to make it too. It's been quite a fun and fulfilling week. But in game-related news, which is what we're here to talk about, let's talk about how important this week was in games. So, first, I want to go ahead and say we're going to do this new thing where we're going to try to go over the games that were released this week and if they're of importance to you guys or if they're not, right? So, this is, again, just our opinions, but I think we have a pretty good feel on what might be interesting games or not. So, going to let Tripp cover that with you guys. So, Tripp, if you want to go over the huge, huge list, because I know there's so many, of games that came out this week that might be relevant to our listeners.
Yeah, absolutely. I don't mind doing that at all. Let me just get an idea of how many. Okay, yeah, one. One single game.
Just and, the one.
it is No Man's Sky, which is, that's all right, because it's a big game. If not in scope, which it absolutely is, then in people's minds. That is going to be our first topic of conversation, I believe. Is that right?
That is right. Yeah. So with the such a limited release games this week, we're just going to really cover a couple of the things. So just to quickly cover the agenda with you guys, we're going to talk briefly about No Man's Sky. We're going to talk a little bit about the Demon Hunter and WoW and how that feels. And then at the end, we're going to discuss some changes in a game we haven't really directly talked about yet, but it's a game that I know I play a heck of a lot of, and I think Tripp does too, Heroes of the Storm. So that's an online MOBA by Blizzard Entertainment, obviously the same company that does WoW. So we play that game probably a little too much. So we're going to talk a little bit about a big patch that came out yesterday and how that might affect the gameplay and stuff going forward, but some interesting stuff to look forward to. But circling back, let's get started talking about the big game for this week, which is No Man's Sky.
Which is like 90% hype is going to be the discussion around No Man's Sky. It's all about like how excited people have been for this. Is this going to be another Peter Molyneux situation where we just get betrayed by all the lies that came out prior to the game's release? But you know, I played it, and it's interesting. It's fun. It feels a lot like Skyrim in space to me. Maybe less combat related, combat focused, but it's a fun game. It's kind of bogged down, in all honesty, by a lot of kind of like things that I believe will be resolved as you progress in the game, like inventory management would be an example. But so far, I have definitely enjoyed it.
Yeah, so I know that there was a huge amount of hype built up over the past 3 years almost. I think 2.5 years is when it was first announced. Maybe longer than that.
I believe it was three. I think I keep hearing three was how long ago it was announced.
Yeah, so 3 years worth of hype. Now, that's kind of a separate topic on its own, right? Like, I don't really think anybody should be announcing games that far out, right? Am I right?
Well, you know, like this is the whole thing. It might not have ever, the game might not have happened without that announcement. There was an incredible support from, you know, potential fans, and that's what attracted Sony, who didn't exactly, I don't think, pour money into it, but they did handle the marketing for it, which is a major aspect of a game getting released. You know, a marketing can make or break a game. So,
and they did,
you know,
go ahead. Sorry. No, I'm just saying they did a good job with it. The marketing. Yeah.
Absolutely, I think so, yeah. And the maker himself, what's his name?
Sean.
Yep, Sean.
Sean, no last name.
He's been very present. He's been very, you know, out front with it. He's been very responsive. He even did an AMA a few days ago, maybe yesterday, I think. And yeah, he's been very much the face of the company and the face of the game itself. You know, I think a good job all around on marketing for that. But I'm again, like you say that's too early to talk about a game that, you know, could just be a potential for a game or something. But yeah, it might be required in some cases.
Well, and I don't disagree. You're absolutely right, because the sheer momentum and marketing behind Sony doing that stuff and adding that to the hype, I mean, that probably did put it, you know, through the ringer, so it gave them the opportunity to keep keep developing it. But I was just kind of talking more along the aspects of, like, the hype train really can kill games, right? Like, we've seen that in the past. Like,
people... Well, it's like, yeah, whether a game is good or bad no longer becomes the issue. It's whether or not it meets expectations.
Yeah.
Which a bad game can meet expectation, and a good game can fail to meet expectations. So, yes, that's very much the case with this.
Yeah, I think that the overhyping started, and now, I mean, because if you look at reviews, like day one reviews and stuff like that, and you see community, you know, comments and YouTube videos and stuff like that, internet communities, right? You'll see people completely trolling it, you know, like, oh, it's super boring. It's never going to live up to our expectations. I can't believe that we waited this long for this game and all sorts of stuff like that. And I think that is directly related to this overhyping effect, right? That,
yeah. Yep.
You just get people stirred up too early, and then, you know, you've unleashed the beast, so to speak.
Yeah, people just get their hopes up. They put their heart and souls into a game's release, and if it disappoints them, it's worse than it being a bad game in general. It's a betrayal, you know? It's
yeah.
It's the ninth circle of hell. So, yeah, it's very much... it can make or break a game's release, and it can make or break your fan base, which is going to be whether or not you get another chance to make another game, you know? And for an upcoming indie studio such as Hello Games, it's a big deal. But no matter what people are negatively saying, people are saying a lot of positive things about it too. And people have certainly enjoyed playing it.
Yeah. Well, so past all the hype talk and stuff, because that's all really opinion based. But since you have played it, let's just talk briefly. I want to ask you a few questions, because these are questions that I have, and I think a lot of listeners might have it too. So, is the game boring? Because I've heard a lot about it being boring, and I've heard a lot of aspects of how it is boring. So what is your thoughts on that?
That is going to be one of the tough ones to answer. You know, you put like a certain person in front of the game, and they're just going to not get it. They're going to narrow their eyes and not be into it, you know, and not quite get what the hell's going on and why would you want to do this. And then you put another type of person in front of it, me, and you'll go over and realize that you've been trying to mine this entire, like, you know, tons and tons of gold for way too long. Like, you know, just trying to break down, because you have a device, a weapon pretty much in the game that you can use to mine and collect materials and, you know, kind of like Minecraft or whatever. And I just sat there and just ripped apart this seam of gold for way too long, just like picking at it and trying to get it all in my bags and my ship and just load up on gold. And that was really fun for me for some reason. And I kept doing that. And it's like, you know, you come across a blueprint for a specific piece of equipment or device, and then that just takes over your imagination and you run off trying to find the different parts that requires and everything. So it's a certain type of person. And I think the thing is, like, you've seen the appeal of Minecraft, and I believe the people who enjoy that will enjoy a part of this game. Now, this game is not really Minecrafty. You can't like build with it necessarily, but you can create equipment to improve your character with it.
Can you talk a little bit about, that's a really good point. Like, can you talk a little bit more about the building? Like, are we in this game, are you going to be able to go build a spaceship, build a spaceport, build a building on a planet's surface? Is that something that's not a thing, is it?
The building on a planet's surface, I can't say one way or the other. I believe I read that was supposed to be a part of future content for the game, but do not quote me on that. It might be just something that's talked about so often as gamers desire that it ends up, you know, being treated as truth, but I'm not sure about that yet. But your equipment, for instance, you'll wander along, you'll find an alien. He'll ask for carbon for some reason. All life forms want carbon in one form or another, I guess.
Why not?
In your bag, it's just a stack of carbon. Yeah. So you give him 20 carbon, and he gives you a gun in return, an upgraded gun for the one that you have. And maybe the one you had like 7 expansion slots, and this gun has 9 expansion slots. So you can, you know, basically outfit it with different capabilities. You can increase its mining speed. You can increase its mining, you know, distance. You can increase its capabilities as a weapon. You can increase its speed of reload or what have you, you know. So you can really modify your weapon, whether it be a weapon or whether it actually be a mining utensil, I guess. Yeah.
So not so much building, but there is certain progressions in terms of using resources to gain other items, right?
Absolutely. And I'm assuming the spaceship's going to be the same way. You either buy a spaceship, get a spaceship, find a spaceship, get gifted with a spaceship, or perhaps even build a spaceship at some point in time, but I have not quite seen the blueprints that would suggest you'd be able to build a spaceship. So I'm guessing you would have to acquire it in some way, either just through sheer purchase or you know, as I said, being given the spaceship that you could then upgrade it and everything. So
yeah. So another thing that was brought to my attention a lot earlier this week when people were talking about No Man's Sky was the survival aspects. So it's my understanding that your suit requires certain types of elements to power it via, you know, either A, keeping your shields up, B, keeping you safe from poison damage, stuff like that. And so I was just curious if you could talk a little bit about, like, is it kind of a survival game?
It's real tough to call it a survival game simply because the tools to tools to further your own survival are just so incredibly available to you. It's tough to say, like, oh, this is a survival game. It's more like a maintenance game, I guess, because you'll, like, wander along and you'll find materials that will restore power to your suit or mm-hmm. restore power to your suit's life support systems or restore power to your suit's its environmental response systems, you know, like those being poison rain or that being deep, really cold temperatures or whatever. So you will need to, like, constantly go into your suit, click on the thing that you need to restore power to, and then choose a source of power for it and restore power.
Is that annoying?
It is, yeah, but this is the thing. Like, this is the thing. Like the suit itself, like I mentioned, inventory management or whatever. So it comes with a certain number of slots to begin with that you can put, like, your materials that you grab. You can put those in a certain number of slots to begin with. Super annoying. So, like, you continue on and you find an expansion to your suit where you can store more materials, right? Mm-hmm. So my assumption is that you'll be able to eventually upgrade these environmental parts of your suit, or like the environmental response or life support parts of your suit, to where they degrade more slowly so that it won't be as annoying. But right off the bat, yeah, these features are kind of annoying. Like, it's kind of a rough start off to the game, you know?
So it's
kind of
like a walk before you can run type thing, right?
Exactly. I know this has been, like, it's a big deal has been made of how, you know, how random it is where you end up when you first start off the game. You know, you are completely just, you know, far away from the center of the universe. You're just kind of slapped on a planet somewhere. I wish they had tried harder to make that planet less unforgiving. You know, like, just like, maybe make it to where you don't have to worry about life support on this planet, or you don't have to worry about maybe more of a tutorial phase. You know, I feel like that would make it a lot less annoying to people. Because the word annoying sadly comes into play a lot with this game. You kind of have to just get over some of those features, and it's not bad at all. It's all very doable, but I can see how that would turn some people off completely.
Yeah, so maybe this game, there's a little bit of the RNGesus situation going on, right? Where if you get into a bad planet to start with, you kind of just screwed, right?
There might be a person who landed on a, like, you know, balmy 85 planet on a beautiful day with, you know, with oxygen and everything, and just not have to worry about it. But that was not me. I had deep freezing temperatures and constantly having that lady tell me that my life support was at 75%, you know, environmental at 50%. It was a bummer.
Yeah.
But, you know, it's, again, I'm enjoying the game. So take my complaints with a grain of salt, but yeah.
Yeah, so I kind of want to cover two more little aspects of this, if you would.
Sure.
So one thing I wanted to talk about was the multiplayer. So I know that it's not, okay?
It's not.
It's not, yeah.
The multiplayer is just not.
Yeah. Well, I don't think there is. But then I have read reviews that said people have ran into other players online, although they couldn't interact with each other. So I'm wondering, is this more like a, you know, Dark Souls, where you can see the phantoms running by, but they'd mean nothing to you? Is that the kind of multiplayer it is?
I couldn't tell you. Yeah, like that might actually be how it is. Like them being there is more like distantly anecdotal, you know? It's like, hey, this person's there. Yes. You're not alone.
So it's
maybe
like,
that's all the message is, just like it was in Dark Souls, you know, like this person's struggling too, type of thing. But again, like he actually said, Sean, the dude, that it was unlikely you'd ever see another person, you know, like one of the updates, the day one patch for it or whatever, that actually made it easier to find other players.
Oh, wow. Okay. Well,
so that was one of the things they did. So it was odd to me that they went to the effort to make it easier to find other players when there still isn't any interaction. So it might just be that they're trying to get that Dark Souls feel. Yeah.
Yeah. Because I know in Dark Souls, at least, I love watching White Phantoms run off cliffs and go, that fucker. You know,
it's a great deal of fun. Yeah.
Yeah. So maybe this will be the same thing, even though, you know, it's not really super hard, difficult combat, or at least from what I've heard. But.
Not so far, not on the ground.
Yeah. And then the last thing I wanted to talk about was, I've heard it many, many times. And by that heard it, I mean, I've read it some on Reddit, you know, and I've heard it from people talking about it. I've heard Sean describe this game as chill, lay back and chill. And I've heard other reviewers say, I've had enough of this action, adrenaline rush, first person shooters. Finally, I can sit down to a game where I can chill. What is that? Yeah, I understand what they're getting at there. And is that what this is to you? Like when you were playing this, are you chilled?
Okay. So I am chilled when I'm wandering around a planet. I'm scanning for life. I'm, you know, grabbing resources. I'm, you know, doing a full scan for, you know, local materials nearby. And I see like a obelisk that I can go over and learn more of the alien language or whatever. There's like, you know, piano pieces in the background, and it's all very, you know, calming and normal, and you're just wandering around with the exception of that lady bitching at you about your life support systems. It's pretty, you know, it's normal. It's great. It's, you know, just calm. Chill is a really good word for it. Yeah. But then you go into space and you are completely unprepared to fight off 12 fighter space fighters. Yeah. Yeah, spider face. I don't know what you call them. Anyways, it's spaceships. Yeah. You have to fight off fighter spaceships or whatever, like almost immediately. And they are just the worst. And I've just gotten my shit kicked in like 8 times in a row. And that's not fun for me. So I usually see those guys and just book it.
Yeah. So you can run from them, though.
I have been able to run it sometimes. Yes. And other times, like I was right at a planet surface and they appeared out of nowhere, and I was like, oh, fuck this, I'm just going to land on the planet, and it would not let me. So that was a huge bummer.
Gotcha.
But, yeah. So every time you die, you have to go get your body again, by the way. You have to go get your resources again.
Well, that's kind of like Dark Souls, in a way.
Yep. That makes me want to punch a baby. But otherwise...
Now, if you die, do you know if you die before you've gone back to this your grave, do you lose your resources, or do they stay there?
That's a good question. I do not know.
Okay. Yeah. I just want
to,
I mean,
do not know. I've never died on the way back to reclaim. I've only died like 3 times, and hey, all of them were from spaceships being assholes, but yeah.
Yeah. Well, sorry to ruin your perfect record with No Man's Sky already. Died 3 times. Terrible. Terrible at it.
Yeah. Well,
for a game that's so chill, you'd think you'd be better. Just
kidding. Well, just kidding. I don't love this side of you, Greg, but let's continue. Okay.
All right, so overall, I know that a lot of people are out there, and they're kind of waiting with their wallets, right? And they're saying, should I pick this up? Because it still hasn't been released on PC, and most of the people that I know are playing games on PC. They did not pick it up on PS4. So for those of them that are waiting still for the Steam release, which is on Friday, August 12th, should they pick it up? I mean, is it worth it? What do you think?
I mean, I think if someone played Skyrim and they got caught up by that feeling of Skyrim or Fallout, you know, a Bethesda game, and they got caught up in that feeling of, I'm going to go do this. I'm totally focused. Let's go get this quest taken. What is that? Let's go walk over here and figure out what that is.
Right.
I think if you ever had that sense, that moment, that thing where you just get distracted easily and you love exploring and finding new, I think this game's for you. In that respect of it. And, you know, I think it's for a lot of people. I believe there probably was some disappointment from some people, but I mean, I would give this game a solid 8 out of 10, maybe 8.5 out of 10, because I haven't seen so much that the game has to offer.
Yeah.
But yeah, I would, I hate giving number reviews on something, but it's fun. I enjoy it.
Well, I mean, so for the listeners that you've heard it here, right? Like, definitely go pick it up. I mean, if you if you have that particular sense of enjoying exploration, right? I think that's kind of what you were hitting on. Like,
and yeah, like that's the thing of it. If you enjoy that exploration aspect of game, then yeah. If you're looking for a first-person shooter,
probably not.
Yeah, hopefully, yeah. But yeah.
Also, for those Minecraft fans, because you know we did make slight references to Minecraft earlier, is this gonna satisfy the Minecraft people or no?
I gotta be honest, I've never played Minecraft, but
oh, I haven't either. Like, it's a thing that I don't do, but I know there's a lot of people that do.
Yeah, I'm not 10, so I haven't played it, but yeah, that's not fair. But yeah, it's I can't really say. Like, if I think Minecraft is more about building, and so far this game doesn't have that aspect to it yet. Like, it might sometime with a future update or something, but from not yet.
Okay. Yeah. So hold off if you just want to build, right?
Yeah. Yep.
All right. Cool. Well, thanks for going over that with me. Because I'm curious too, and now I think I am going to actually pick it up on Friday, so that'll be good. So moving right along, something else that I wanted to talk about this week, which is huge in the video game community, is the release of the Demon Hunter in WoW. Now Tripp and I sat down last night and I got to watch him play through some of the opening area for newly created Demon Hunters, and I have to say the first feeling that I got from sitting there watching you do that was very nostalgic. You know, I was like, wow, this feels like home. You know, I haven't been in WoW in years, but yet it was still very comfortable to watch you play through it.
Yeah, the bars and everything, it's the action bars, and it's all the same. Yeah, it hasn't changed a lot as far as that aspect of it, but yeah, they're making it. It feels really good.
Yeah. So now you've played a pretty good bit at Demon Hunter. So kind of, if you just want to go ahead and give the listeners just a little summary of what you think the Demon Hunter brings to the game, and do you like it?
Yeah, it's kind of odd to say, like, you know, they really don't have a lot else they can do with a DPS or a tank right now, but, because they've really done a lot, you know, especially with a melee DPS, there's several of those. And, you know, with a tank, there's several of those, but, right now the tank aspect of it, you know, they have a couple of cooldowns where it's, 30% damage reduction or, you know, like increases the healing of the thing or whatever. But
oh Lord, did somebody just break into your house?
That is my cat. I will kill him later. Don't worry.
Okay, God.
But yeah,
thank God you're safe.
Like right now, the part of the actual tank aspect of them is that you beat on something and it knocks off shards of their soul, which then you can reabsorb as health, and that's kind of like the tank thing. So it's a heal tank. Yeah, you know, it's a self healing
like
tank.
Like a drain tank. Yeah.
Yep, drain tank. Essentially, yeah, and so yeah, with a few other cooldowns, and then the Demon Hunter slants on that, which is that, you know, you can metamorphosis and you gain 30% health and everything. And you also have what's pretty much Heroic Leap, I think. Is that the warrior ability?
Yeah.
That lets you basically ground target an area to leap to, and you can do that twice in a row. You have two charges of that with your tank. So yeah, you know, AoE damage, which is the fell fire thing, which surrounds you with angry fire that attracts, you know, helps you grab groups of enemies and stuff. So it's fun, you know, and honestly there's eight or six more talent tiers to go through, as well as the artifact weapon. So it's tough to really say ahead of time. I don't think they were even trying to give it a full kit, you know, maybe just the bare bones required so that you could do some content with it before Legion. But yeah, it's really cool feeling right now. I really like it.
I can't believe you didn't talk about eye lasers, like, because I saw that and I was immediately,
we're talking about the tank right now. The tank doesn't actually get the eye lasers.
Oh, well, then you should probably never be a tank, yeah.
Yeah, that's the Havoc spec, which is the DPS spec. And the tank is called Vengeance, I think.
Yeah.
But the Havoc spec is the DPS spec. You get eye lasers, and you get, like, a backflip, which does damage as you jump away. And then you have your forward, you know, Illidan's zoom forward ability.
Because why not? Called. Sweeping strikes.
Sweeping strikes, probably, yeah. And you, like, can hit your button to do a backflip, then hit the zoom forward ability, and you shoot right back into the action, and it's just a lot of movement and craziness, and, you know, it's going to be a lot of fun for a lot of people who like that feeling. It's like a more in-your-face rogue, I guess, with several pretty healthy defensive cooldowns on the DPS spec too. So I think they're going to be a lot of fun in PvP. People are probably going to like them. But yeah.
Yeah, cool. All right. Well, good. So, and I have a couple of questions now too about this, and I think you might be able to help me answer them. So, the expansion Legion that we're waiting on that's coming, right? Because full expansion is not until the end of this month, right?
Yep. Yep.
Okay.
Yep.
So, does that expansion bring like new bosses, new totally new raids? Is it going to be like resetting what the in game raiding situation looks like, or do you know?
Well, I mean, I'm assuming. Yeah. I mean, certainly. I don't really have to assume. Yes, they do that with every expansion. You know, each new expansion comes with new raids, new bosses, and usually it doesn't start off with the full content, of course. They release it gradually and expand the story as patches go by. So, like, right at the very beginning, you might not be able to walk out and kill Gul'dan, but he might, just like Arthas was, you know, a few patches into the actual expansion, you'll be able to fight him.
Oh, nice. I did play during the Arthas expansion, and I did love going in to face the Lich King. It was really cool. So,
yep, that Wrath of the Lich King thing. It started off, you know, kind of, I don't remember what the initial raids in Lich King were, but they weren't super exciting. But
Naxxramas, was it? It
was rehashed from Classic, yeah.
Yeah. Naxxramas was the big one in there, I think. And then
Naxxramas, yeah, yeah, yep. And then you did that at the very beginning, and then, you know, they kept releasing patches, and you eventually got to fight in Ice Crown Citadel.
Yeah, I remember riding out there a bunch of times. So I guess I'm kind of sad to hear that because, you know, the new expansion bringing about a whole new set of raids and raid bosses, because I guess our friend Mav is not going to be around for many games much in the coming future.
We're going to lose him. But the leveling process, you know, 100 to 110, that's going to be a thing. That's going to be that's going to grab a lot of people, probably me included. But yeah,
goodbye, all my friends to WoW. Yeah, that's the thing I noticed. Even this week, right, my whole friends list on Battle.net is just completely WoW. You know.
Yep. Everyone has that little W emblem on there. You should join us, then. You should join us.
Well, you know, I'm resisting the dark side right now, so maybe.
It feels so good over here.
Yeah. yeah, cool. So I'm looking forward to some more updates, and I'm sure we'll keep covering it as big things come out before we get to the final end week of the last of August, where we can actually play the full expansion. So
interestingly enough, there's like a little bit of pre-expansion content right now. You know, you can run out and fight off a legion of the legion, a horde of legion. And you can go off and do that. It'll give you some level 700 gear once you clear it. I actually got 3 pieces in the last one that I fought. And it's a real quick way to level up for the Legion content, or level up your gear for the Legion content. So yeah. Nice. And then there's another scenario you can run through as like the last, or the first, I guess, the first quest line for the Legion content. Another scenario you can run through, and it'll give you a nice weapon and stuff.
Nice. All right. Well, hopefully everybody I would say go out and try it, but I mean, everyone that is going to try it is probably playing it already, as I mentioned earlier. So we don't really have to sell this game or even have to recommend it. We can just say it happens and it's going to happen. So moving right along then. So finally this week, before we run out of time here, I just wanted to talk a good bit about Heroes of the Storm, because it's a game that I've played, for over a year now, and I've had a lot of fun with it. I know you and I, Mav, a bunch of my friends, we all play, and it's really been fulfilling. So for those of you that don't know what HOTS is, Heroes of the Storm, it's a online MOBA brawler, as they say, which is, you know, similar to the League of Legends and Dota, but it's more team oriented, and they've done away with the gold and item systems and replaced that with talent specs for the heroes. So it's slightly different. The games are quicker. Overall, it just kind of fits more my speed of game, right? And so we haven't did any coverage of HOTS, you know, before this episode, but I knew it was going to sneak in here because we do mess around with it a good bit. So I just want to take a second to talk about the patch notes that came out for this past Tuesday, because the game is constantly being updated. So we recently got a patch, including a new hero, which is Ariel. What would we call her? Oreo, or just Ariel?
I'm just going to call it Ariel because that's what it looks like and it sounds angelic.
Or Ariel under the sea? I don't know, like Little Mermaid?
I think that, That AU just screams all.
Oh, so, yeah. Yeah, good point. Okay, so so we get the new support hero, Ariel. And Tripp and I spent a good amount of time playing with her yesterday. And, yep, and so
I'm best in A.
Yeah, Tripp is on a 100% win rate, best in A with Ariel. So why don't you kind of give me an idea about what you feel about Ariel?
She feels really good. Like, usually with a support, now there are obviously some exceptions, but she's the only support to me that feels viable from a damage aspect as well as from a healing aspect. Her damage is converted into energy, which she can then use to actually heal herself and her companions, and with certain talents, actually damage the enemy. But she can then, I'm going to call it hat still, even though that's Abathur's thing. She basically puts a halo on one of her companions, and then she absorbs a portion of their damage that they deal out, Jake, and a portion of the damage that they can receive if you take a certain talent. And yeah, so she's a really cool kind of like balance that you have to do. She has a really good knockback, really solid knockback for her in her whip that she has, and yeah, she's a lot of fun for me. I love the way her talents can really, you can focus in on the healing or you can focus in more on positioning and everything. And yeah, she's a lot of fun.
Yeah, I've had a good amount of fun with her too. And I was really excited to get some more supports in the game because as long as we've been playing, this game has been kind of support dry almost. I mean, obviously this game is a little bit younger than a lot of the others. There's a lot less hero pool to choose from. And even less support heroes. So
yeah.
I'm glad to see another support hero in the game. I'm really excited.
Are you looking at 9 now or 8 now?
9, yeah.
9 now.
Yeah, I think so. But yeah, that's really good. I'm looking forward to going out and playing some as her and with her to see if, you know, maybe this changes the meta a little bit, maybe just slightly. Well,
people are hoping that it would bring Cho'Gall, you know, into a more common play because he kind of has been very, very absent lately. But
God help Cho'Gall.
Yep, her particular halo gets double from the damage that they deal. So it's a really cool type of synergy there between those two characters, those three characters maybe. But yeah.
Yeah, so you're getting the damage from Cho, the damage from Gall, both, right, is your energy, right?
And the damage from Ariel is her energy. Yeah, like, sure. We actually played a game with her last night, and we destroyed them because we're so good. But, yeah, she almost always seemed to have a full energy bar.
You mean Zagara destroyed them, basically.
Well, you and I did the actual fighting, and then happily there was what appeared to be an AI bot, Zagara, running around the map just doing everything else.
Yeah, she did seem a lot like AI, right? Because... We were definitely sitting there fighting. It was 2v5, you know.
It was a long, long time for 2v5. And, yeah, we just kept expecting. I think I just kept expecting the other three members of our team to rush in and save us. And it didn't happen. And it wasn't necessary for a really long time. But, yeah, we did well, I think. We did really well. You were awesome on Stitches.
When we had one of those moments where we're still running away. And then all of a sudden, it's good game. The core's gone. And we're like, how did we win? What? Like,
we realized it was all Zagara just pushing the entire time. But, I mean, obviously, you know, we kept him busy so she could do all that. But it was a really interesting game, a really different game.
Yeah. Also, one quick little news section that I want to just add on here is the Dota 2 TI, or otherwise known as the International, is on this week. It's on twitch.tv.com/Dota2TI. If you guys are interested in watching that, it's pretty amazing. Like, I don't necessarily play Dota, but I love watching it. Because it's the production value of this tournament, the TI, is just incredible. You'd have to see it to believe it. You know, I get one of those moments where I'm like, okay, the future's now, you know, like we've did it, boys. We got video games as on the main stage and we've done it. So
we're getting there. People are making money as an esports.
Yeah,
I think we should just stop calling it sports, though, because, I mean, come on.
just E. That's it.
E something. E games.
Yeah. Or just video games.
Yeah.
Video games tournament.
Yep.
All right.
Just call it a sport. It's just, it's misleading. Anyway, it's fine.
Yeah. Anyway, so I guess we're going to go ahead and wrap it up here. I had a lot of fun talking about this stuff with you, Tripp, and hopefully... we will have some interesting stuff to talk about next week. So
Let's hope so.
All right, man. Well, have a good rest of the week. I'll talk to you soon.
Later, man.
See you, everybody. Thank you.